wings fall apart, the center cannot hold, mere anarchy is loosed upon the world. Tide is loosed, and everywhere the ceremony of innocence is drowned. The best lack all conviction, while the worst are full of passionate intensity.
The National Defense Act of 1916 established, as a matter of law, that the United States would call upon the National Guard before it would raise any volunteer units to go to war.
The greatest advocates for the Guard, the leaders within it, really saw themselves as an integral part of the National Defense Establishment, and that meant if the United States was going to go to war abroad, the National Guard would be doing that as well.
Within months, this new law would be put to the test, when Pancho Villa and his raiders attacked the Texas towns of Glen Springs and Boquillas. President Wilson called on the National Guard, and Wisconsin responded. The Wisconsin Guard mustered at Camp Douglas, units that would later make up the lion's share of the 32nd Division.
So this was a watershed moment in the history of the Guard, coming on the heels of that National Defense Act. It was an opportunity to prove themselves as men and to prove that the citizen soldier tradition of the United States was still not only viable, but essential to our military policy.
By summer 1916, Wisconsin's Guard was on duty in Texas. They started coming home in December 1916, just as the U.S. began the seismic shift to war.
We left in 1916, and we came back in February 1917.
Edward Denomi, a Native American and member of Wisconsin's National Guard, was called up to federal service in Texas following the Pancho Villa raids. His unit had just returned home when it became clear that the U.S. would enter the war. Wisconsin's mobilization began well before President Wilson asked Congress for a war declaration.
And we were home about a month, and we were called out for World War I. So we had to go down to Camp Douglas again, six regiments of infantry from the National Guard, plus two regiments from Michigan, put them all together down at Waco, Texas, and made 32nd Division.
Denomi was one of dozens of Native American members of the Guard, many from the Ho-Chunk Reservation near Tolma, Wisconsin.
Also, different Wisconsin tribes had members of the Wisconsin National Guard as well. So the Ho-Chunk, the Oneida, the Menominee, all had people who would go to war with the National Guard.
Denomi was not a U.S. citizen. He was exempt from the draft. He was one of more than 12,000 Native Americans who served with distinction. As it became clear the U.S. would enter the war, the Guardsmen returning from service in Texas prepared for a new mission.
These are proto-professional guardsmen. They're dual professionals. They have civilian vocations, and they are committed to this particular profession of arms as well.
In addition to the National Guard mobilizations, volunteer units were raised in communities throughout Wisconsin, sometimes spontaneously.
At the outbreak of World War I, there was no National Guard unit in Platteville.
Scott Carey had served in the Iowa National Guard. In 1917, he was living in Platteville, Wisconsin, but wanted to serve.
I called the governor and he directed me to the Adjutant General. The Adjutant General informed me to get 150 men as rapidly as I could get them. We enlisted about 300, but 202 passed the physical examination.
Carey was commissioned a first lieutenant and mobilized his company of Platteville men to Wisconsin's military reservation at Camp Douglas, Wisconsin. Around the state, a massive shift of manpower began, with farmers and laborers, businessmen and university professors, answering the nation's call to service.
We mobilized at Camp Douglas August 4th, 1917. We remained there until September 30th when we moved to Waco, Texas, Camp McGraha. There we went into training, the reorganization and organization of the 32nd Division. Up to that time, it had not been organized.
Carey was not alone in his efforts to augment the Guard's strength. Throughout the state, community leaders seeking to serve gathered others willing to do their part. In Milwaukee, parishioners of the Evangelical Lutheran Church of the Ascension gave their pastor, Gustav Stearns, leave to join the war effort. He had just returned from Texas, where he had served as chaplain for the Wisconsin National Guard soldiers during the Mexican border crisis. Captain Paul Schmidt, commander of Company C's 2nd Wisconsin Infantry, mustered his men for a second time. They had just returned from Texas. Wisconsin's National Guard and new Guard units gathered together at local armories, horse parks, and fairgrounds for training, and then moved on to Camp Douglas. On July 18, 1917, while the Wisconsin National Guard prepared at their home armories, the Army issued General Order 95, creating the 32nd Division with troops from Michigan and Wisconsin. Major General William G. Hahn, a regular Army officer and West Point graduate, assumed command. Midwinter 1917, and the 32nd Division, full strength, trained to General Pershing standards, began the daunting task of moving more than 22,000 men across an ocean, hunted by German submarines. The 32nd traveled light. They left their equipment behind.
Essentially, we reached an agreement with the British and the French early on that we would devote all the shipping space we had for personnel, and we would leave the artillery and tanks and aircraft that we had, which wasn't much early in the war, we'd leave that behind, and our allies would equip us when we got there.
While the 32nd sailed, the threat of German submarines was never far away. In the early morning hours of February 5th, the Tuscania was attacked off the coast of Ireland by the German submarine UB-77. It carried a crew of 384 and more than 2,000 American soldiers, many from the 32nd. The division headquarters landed in Liverpool in mid-February, crossing the channel to Le Havre. Others made landfall at Brest on the western shores of France.
We arrived at 11:30 a.m., and the men were immediately put to work constructing warehouses. There were to be 52 of these buildings, each 500 feet in length, to be used for storing supplies. The American troops also laid 16 miles of railroad track.
The division was spread across France, from the Bordeaux to the Haute-Marne. The plan, as laid out before the 32nd left Texas, was to use the division as a replacement unit, separating its parts and filling in existing units. The 128th Infantry went immediately to the front to replace troops in the 1st Infantry Division.
The 128th Infantry reached the 10th Area in March and bore the brunt of the replacement blow, just as it was destined to bear the brunt of other blows later on.
The replacement work lasted about 4 weeks. During that time, the privates and captains of the 128th were transferred to the 1st Division, who had completed their training and were already in the trenches. General Hahn, a longtime colleague of General Pershing's, lobbied to keep his division together.
The alleged reason is for the saving of transportation, but by careful reading of the telegram, it will be seen that practically no transportation will be saved. I wish it distinctly understood that I am ready to do anything or to have the troops of my division placed anywhere, provided they are so utilized as to produce the best general effect.
Hahn argued that his division had trained together and would fight best together, and that any perceived logistical savings would be an illusion. Hahn made his point, and the leadership agreed. The unit came together in the Alsace, where the combat was less intense, and the division could gain critical combat experience and additional training.
In point of fact, they really did need to learn the hard, tedious lessons of how to live and fight in a static defensive form of warfare in order to survive that environment and get to the point where they could use maneuver-based warfare.
A part of the training consisted in the construction of trenches. In the rocky soil of this part of France, trench digging was more of a mining than an agricultural operation.
By the 18th of May, the 1st Combat Troops of the 32nd Division were assigned combat duty in Alsace, the first American forces to fight on German soil.
Johnny, get your gun, get your gun, get your gun. Take it on the run, on the run, on the run.
Captain Schmidt recalls the naivete of his troops, climbing cherry trees to pick fruit and being shot at by snipers. And on the morning after they arrived, they were welcomed with a message from the Germans.
An interesting sidelight showing the thoroughness of the German spy system was the surprise of our troops the following morning when they looked over the parapet of the trenches to observe a long banner stretched over the German trenches reading, "Welcome, 32nd Division."
By June, all but 2,000 of the division were together on the Alsace front, in direct contact with the German army. They were being trained by the French for a planned move to the combat-intense Western Front.
They say that so large a body of troops, such as the Germans are using in this offensive, perhaps approximately 1 million men, cannot be stopped until after a considerable advance has been made, but that it will recoil as soon as its flanks are attacked, and possibly with disastrous results.
General Hahn had a clear picture of the fight. The German army offensive of March 1918 sought to split the French and British forces, isolate the French from the fight, and concentrate on forcing the British out of the war before the American forces could become fully engaged.
The Americans are green, not well trained perhaps, and their commanders had yet to really see the kind of total warfare that was being fought in Europe with tremendous modern firepower. The result is the Americans make many of the same mistakes the British and the French had made in 1914, and the cost is horrendous.
General Hahn worked his division hard, pushing it in its final month in the Alsace before being put into the crucible.
My training schedule for officers calls for 12 hours work a day, and the man who doesn't come up to the mark loses his job without further ceremony. In the last 60 days, 82 have been eliminated for lack of energy. I don't believe in sending men into battle under men who themselves do not have the energy to fill their own jobs, so I just relieve them. I expect they will go to the service of the rear some other place. I don't care much where.
We began a season of very intensive training in target practice and formations in French tactics under French instructors. One French instructor was assigned to each battalion.
While this time was considered training, it was also time in direct contact with the enemy.
Where we are now located, it is forbidden to have any large outdoor gatherings, as we are within easy range of the German guns, and German aeroplanes may come sailing over us at any time.
At the end of May, four battalions of the 32nd were on the front line, and General Hahn received word from the French that their work was satisfactory.
So we got into the Alsace Lorraine sector, which was a quiet sector. A fire country like that. The Germans didn't want to shot up, and the French didn't want to shot up. So they're in there for training, both of them. We had trenches on both sides.
It was here that the division experienced its first combat casualties.
I had a man killed yesterday and another one today by machine gun fire and the other one by artillery. Another one was slightly wounded today. These are my first casualties in battle, and I take it we will soon get some more. As I am dictating, some shells are exploding. Some of ours are exploding on the other side.
I was in the front line trenches the day he was killed. His name was Private Kenneth Counter. He was a member of my regiment. He was not, however, a Milwaukee boy.
On the morning of May 27th, the Germans amassed a large force and began a surprise offensive. Hahn credits German discipline for its rapid success, having marched their divisions by night and remaining out of sight of airplane reconnaissance.
And in that way concentrated some 20 or 30 divisions back of the line preparatory for the present offensive, which, according to the last reports, is still progressing on a line about 5 kilometers south of Vesle between Soissons and Reims.
In the coming weeks, the 32nd would meet the German army on this ground. Until then, their time in the Alsace grew more intense.
When the Germans come in, they mistook a machine gun post was out there for the dugout, and they opened up with liquid fire. Well, that two and I guys off, and so they just returned the fire like that, and there were some of those guys. They killed some of them, wounded a couple, they took some prisoners.
More and more of Chaplain Stern's time was spent performing funeral rites for both American and German soldiers.
It was in perfect harmony with military regulations to bury any soldier who was killed in action, whether he was one of our comrades or not. It was likely that the parents of the dead soldier would learn where he was killed and would come to this place in search of his grave.
In late July, the division was pulled off the line in the Alsace and moved to Chatel Terray and their first offensive operations.
Our route took us through the devastated territory laid bare by the terrible conflicts which were waged between the French, American, and German armies. Fields jagged with shell holes, towns destroyed, and graves marked with crosses gave mute and tragic testimony of the fearful carnage of life left in the wake of these sanguinary struggles.
The German army had been driven out by the 3rd Division and the French forces.
It was still light enough to notice evidence of the beauty of this locality. Before the ravages of war blasted the landscape, we continued to march through the city, our hungry troops who had nothing to eat since the day before, pulling whatever vegetables could be found growing in the gardens and eating them raw.
Captain Schmidt and the 127th Infantry crossed the Marne and waited.
We were now in the fighting area, and the 32nd Division was prepared for real action.
We are no longer in the place where we were when I wrote my last weekly letter. We had been occupying the frontline trenches of a certain sector for about 2 months, but we have now been moved to a sector which is much more active and where the warfare is entirely different.
In the Alsace, the war was fought from the trenches.
Where we are now, it is battles in the open, and trenches are not dug or used, because we are taking part in a big drive.
This would be warfare General Hahn and the Allied forces had sought, a maneuver conflict fought on open ground. Captain Schmidt and his men were ordered forward, and to hold that ground until troops arrived on his right flank.
I sent 10 men forward with ammunition supplies. These men advanced cautiously, but were met with a deadly fire from the enemy guns. Floyd Riffel of Chilton was instantly killed. Riffel was the first man of Company C killed in battle on foreign soil.
Schmidt then moved his company forward en masse.
We advanced about 1 mile, marching through a deep ravine, the men going forward single file by squads, with 25 yards between squads, until both companies reached Roncher.
He searched for the command post, but he could not immediately find it.
I found an aid station in charge of Lieutenant Otto Hintz, a dentist from Oshkosh. This was a veritable charnel house. I never saw so much blood at one time, and I earnestly trust that I shall never have to look upon so much human gore. Lieutenant Hintz was almost exhausted, and a short time later collapsed. He had performed the almost incredible task of dressing the wounds and taking care of 172 men that day.
The American conception of open warfare was not necessarily as misplaced as it might have seemed. Unfortunately for the Americans, because of their lack of training and because of their preference for aggressive tactics, didn't necessarily practice what we would today consider to be the fundamentals of fire and movement or fire maneuver when crossing over these open spaces.
General Hahn assumed command of the sector from the 3rd Division.
The woods were covered with machine guns, but our troops took it by storm and bayoneted the Germans in the woods when they made a counterattack on one of their flanks. The bayonet fight took place at 11 at night and lasted half an hour. So far as I can ascertain, not a shot was fired, and the Germans were completely routed. More than 30 of them were buried on this spot. Here, no prisoners were taken.
But when the 32nd Division, for instance, makes its initial debut in combat, it's still very green, and its mistakes are those of ambitious, aggressive, offensive-minded troops who want to take the fight to the enemy, but have not yet learned the finer art of joint doctrine.
Hahn's diary indicates he maintained a pragmatic view of the fight.
More than 500 Germans were buried on this hill and in Grimpitz Woods, so that the German dead exceeded by 100% the American dead, which is evidence that our men attacked in a scientific manner.
The division moved from La Charnelle to Ranchère, and from there advanced to Siège. From Hahn's new vantage point, he saw the need to claim the high ground, a hill just north of Bellevue, identified on the map by its elevation, Hill 230.
The position marked by Bellevue Farm and 230-meter hill, which was the center and the key to the whole line, was carried after fierce fighting.
The 125th and 126th Infantry, composed of Michigan troops, were on our left during this engagement. Suddenly, from in front of us, over in the direction where we knew the Germans were located, we saw skyrocket signals and flares go up, and then the boom, boom, boom of artillery, and then the zip, zip, zip multiplied a thousandfold of the machine guns, and then some shells came crashing over toward us, and someone yelled, "Gas!"
Pushed from the high ground, the Germans gave way rapidly. The division gained about 6 kilometers and found themselves in front of their flanking units, the French 4th and the American 42nd Division, by more than a mile. General Hahn continued his push.
The order to carry on as rapidly as possible was received, and the next day the division pushed into the hills south of the Vesle River, where it came under heavy artillery fire from the north of that river.
The objective of this offensive was the city of Fismes, a key railroad center on the banks of the Vesle.
The Germans had spared no effort in making this city and surrounding country as impregnable as science could make it. Huge stores of ammunition and engines of destruction were located here, and preparations made to withstand the most formidable attack.
The hills on the opposite banks were within 800 meters of the river and had a command over the river of 240 feet in elevation.
While Captain Schmidt was emplacing his soldiers outside of Fismes, he was spied in the open by a German machine gunner.
My first intimation that I was being made a target was the song of the bullets. My one salvation was to make the gunner think he got me. Acting on this impulse, I suddenly threw up both hands as a man who had really been hit would do and fell heavily to the ground, feigning dead.
Schmidt laid on the ground for more than 2 hours until the dark of night masked his movement.
I rose and walked back to the trench, feeling that I had had enough and convinced that I had been as near death as any man could be and still be alive.
This was while the 2nd and 3rd Battalions fought within the city, pushing the Germans once again backwards.
We could see the Germans retreating across the river into Fismes and up the hills on the opposite side, keeping up a heavy fire with both artillery and machine guns in their retreat.
After the enemy had concentrated his artillery on Fismes for a short time in the afternoon, he attacked the town in force via Chassel's farm at 4:30 p.m. He succeeded in pushing through the line of outposts, forcing back the forces detailed to defend the town and capturing it.
The victory in Fismes marked the end of the division's first offensive. Hahn estimated his losses in killed and wounded above 4,000. With replacements and recuperation, he estimated his division could be ready to fight again in 2 weeks' time. And with this victory, he saw the beginning of the end of the German army.
It is doubtful to me whether the Germans have left the sufficient strength to make another big offensive, and I'm not sure but that a quick offensive by the Allies on the north might not place him in a bad position for the winter.
Collectively, we could call this the Second Battle of the Marne, and there's subordinate engagements with it, but it really is a turning point in the war because the culmination of the last German attack in the Marne sector in mid-July 1918 is the precise moment when the Germans lose the initiative in this war and they never regain it. The 32nd Division is one of those follow-on forces in that northward moving pincer that culminates near the Vesla River, and the 32nd experiences its first trial in combat during that offensive and completes the defeat of German forces that had been defending in that sector. And so the 32nd is a vital cog in a larger Allied effort, French and American effort, to turn the tide.
Meanwhile, the division would shelter and rest, awaiting replacements, and Chaplain Stearns would write another letter to his home church.
I should like to write a much longer letter, but I have looked at my watch and I must get busy with other duties. I must bury the dead.